right in the confine of the time that I have, I am not really preaching. I want to bless you as your matriarch. There are blessings that are found only in the mother's mouth. The father is the head. The father is everything. The father is the pillar. But I have received a commandment, O house of Agape, as your matriarch, to bless you. If you escape one, you can't escape three. If you escape number five, you can't escape number 14. If you escape number 17, you can't escape number 50. But from tonight, I want you to take a cursory look at your life very well. Every aspect of your life, the seven aspects of every human being's life that are very crucial. From tonight, you are shifting. Remember that amen is not an encouragement to the preacher. Amen is the acceptance of a divine verdict. So when I pray for you, make sure your amen is very, very loud. From this moment that God has laid his hands upon me and I have become a spiritual microphone in his hands, you are shifting. Where are you shifting to? In the book of Luke chapter number 19, the Bible says that Lazarus was a short man, but he wanted to see Jesus. So what did he do? He ran. He went forward. But he didn't just go forward. He now went upward. He climbed a tree. And these are the two things that will happen to you. You will go forward and you will go upward. I'm taking my foundational scripture from a very popular passage of the Bible, Matthew chapter 21. And I want to read from verse number 1, King James's version. Matthew chapter 21 from verse 1. And when they drew nigh unto Jerusalem and were come to Bethphage, unto the Mount of Olives, then sent Jesus two disciples. Please preach with me, so be very fast. Saying unto them, go into the village over against you, and straightway you shall find an ass tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them unto me. And if any man say unto you, ye shall say the Lord hath need of them, and straightway he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell ye the daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh unto thee, meek, and sitting upon an ass, and he called the foal of an ass. And the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them, and brought the ass and the colt, and put on them their clothes, and they set him thereon. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and struck them in the way. And the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he was coming to Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, who is this? And the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee. May the Lord bless the reading of his word in our hearts in the name of Jesus. Powerful, powerful, powerful incident. Let's go on this journey. In case you need a title, I want to speak tonight on shifting into endless honor. That is what God laid on my heart. And anytime God wants to help a man, he sends two things, his word and his prophet. Both are here tonight. I am here to be used of God to shift you into endless honor. If I talk about money, fine. If I talk about relationship, fine. But my assignment tonight has to do with honor. Honor. You are shifting, but you are not shifting into shame. You are not shifting into disgrace. You are shifting, 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 shifting into honor. Let your amen be louder than your neighbor's. I'm angry tonight at whatever limitation. restriction or inhibition you have been experiencing. If God could take me from the backside where I was hawking to pay school fees, and today I can't even remember how many children I'm sponsoring in school, that God is shifting you into honor. Don't forget, I keep telling you, if you're not tired of where you are is tired of you. Let's go on this journey. When they drew nigh unto Jerusalem, verse 1, and were come to Bethphage. When they drew nigh unto Jerusalem, Jesus and the disciples had been walking and trekking. And then as they drew nigh, when they got close to Jerusalem, Jesus said, enough of trekking. Enough of toiling. When you trek, you sweat. And when you sweat, you smell. Too many people are trekking. Yes, you graduated, you got a job, and they pay you 25,000 naira, you are trekking. You're married, you have two kids, or three kids, or four kids. You, your wife, and four kids, and your house help, and your mother-in-law, and your mother, when they visit, driving one car to church, you are trekking. The landlord has made you the chief tenant, so you are the one collecting rent, you are trekking. They say there is traffic jam on Agape Avenue, but your car is not one of the cars causing traffic jam. You are trekking. When they came close to Jerusalem, Jesus said, you have been walking. You have been trekking. I know you have covered some grounds. I know you've seen some breakthroughs. I know you've experienced some good times. But stop trekking. Stop trekking. It's time to go up. The Bible says that the point at which Jesus spoke was called Bethphage. What's the meaning of Bethphage? A place of young figs. F-I-G-S. Young figs. Immature figs. Fig trees are where you get olives. And Bible history has made us to understand that Bethphage is where Mount Olives is. That was where Jesus prayed, and that was where Jesus ascended in Acts chapter 1. When Jesus got to Bethphage, that Mount Olives, he stood on the day he was going to go up. While others were watching, he was ascending. And some of you tonight, you are in Bethphage. Or at your Bethphage. And God is the clearing. Enough of trekking. Jerusalem is just there. But you cannot trek to Jerusalem. You must ride on something. You must leave the ground. I'll try as much as possible not to preach tonight because I really want to prophesy. Some people die in their Bethphage, where the olive oil is, or the olive fruits are immature. They can't produce oil yet. Bethphage is where young olive is, young fig trees. Some people die struggling in their Bethphage. They die in their young life. They die when their business is still young. Some die when their marriages are young. In Bethphage, oil doesn't come out yet. And oil is very important because in Psalm 104 verse 15, The Bible says, and wine that maketh glad the heart of man, and oil to make his face to shine, and bread which strengtheneth man's heart. You need these three things. These are the definitions of mega shift. Do not tell me that you shifted if you don't have oil that makes your face shine. Don't tell me that you have shifted if there is no bread in your life. If you still beg, don't tell me if there is no wine. Today, the wine, the oil, and the bread will come into your life. Ecclesiastes chapter 10 and verse number 19. Ecclesiastes 10, 19. A feast is made for laughter, and wine maketh merry, but money answereth all things. I love when people condemn people and say, they don't know. They just talk about money. So why do they wake up and go to work? Why do they stay in traffic? Is it not money they are looking for? Money answereth all things. I've been poor before, so I know what I'm talking about. You will not lack money. Many people die in their Bethphage. Look at Genesis chapter 11 and verse number 31. We see a man that died in his Bethphage. Terah is his name, Abraham's father. Then Terah took Abraham his son, and Lot the son of Haran his son's son, and Sarai his daughter-in-law, his son Abraham's wife, and they went forth with them from Ur of the Chaldees to go into the land of Canaan. And they came to Haran and dwelt there. They were going to Canaan, but they came to Haran. And the days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. You will not die in Bethphage. When they got to Bethphage, Jesus said, everybody, excuse me, we're celebrating different levels. We're celebrating all the miracles, but I dare to be different. I'm tired of trekking. Jerusalem is there. I need to ride. I need to shift. The next level that you are going into, beloved, trekking won't work. Step by step promotion won't work. Salary will not. Handout will not. Depending on what people give you only will not work. In Acts chapter 3, verse 6, Acts chapter 3, verse 6, the Bible says, then Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. So the destination was rise up and walk. But look at the process. Verse 7, he took him by the right hand, lifted him up, and immediately the feet and ankle bones received strength. This is strange. Very strange. Peter took him by the hand, but it was his ankle and feet that needed help. What has the hand got to do with the leg and the ankle bones? The ankle bones and the legs were the reason why he was a beggar. The ankle bones and the feet, both of them were the reason why he was at the mercy of people, like some of you. The reason why you are depending on people is because your ankle bones are weak. And it is your ankle bones that speaks about establishment, that talks about speed, that talks about progress, that talks about shifting. But Peter said, I know that is what has a problem, but it is your hand I need. I need to bless the works of your hands. Once the works of your hands are blessed, then your ankle bones and your feet will receive strength. Everybody stretch your two hands, whether you are a student, whether you are a worker, no matter who you are. Remember, I came to prophesy tonight. Receive strength. Your mates will no longer leave you behind. You will no longer be dependent only on what people give you. If you believe it, shout a bold amen. Take your seat. We are just warming up. The Bible says he took him by the right hand and lifted him up. Show your right hand to God. Say, Father. See Olu Funke's hands. Lift me up. Father, look at my right hand and lift me up. One more time. Say, Father, behold my right hand and lift me up. Take your seat. I did a short study on the significance of the right hand. And I discovered that the right hand is the special place of honor. People that are very important to you, when they come visiting, you want to put them, want them to sit by your right hand. And it is scriptural. You remember in the book of Genesis chapter 48, the patriarch was going home, Jacob, and Joseph brought the children and said, Father, bless them. The Bible says the man crossed his hand because he wanted the right hand that signifies special place of honor to be on a particular boy's hand. That was why I said you should raise your right hand. The right hand is very, very, very crucial. In Isaiah chapter 41, verse number 10, God says, fear not, I am with you. Be not dismayed, I am your God. I will strengthen you, I will help you. Yea, I will uphold you with the right hand of my righteousness. Even God is referring to the right hand. I'm taking you on a journey tonight. And verse 13, for I, the Lord, thy God, will hold thy right hand. Raise your right hand to heaven. Saying unto them, fear not, I will help you. Say, Lord, help me. God is here and we are talking to him. Put your hands down. In that Acts chapter number 3, when Peter held that man's hand, the man first got up on the strength of Peter. But at a point, he began to walk by himself. When you are dependent on people, sometimes it's fine until they get tired of you and they begin to refuse to pick your calls and they begin to dodge you. I'm sure there are some of you, when you see the number, you say, oh, I've not even blocked this person. No matter the kindness of any human being, at a point, if you are always depending on them, they will get tired. That's one of the reasons why God raised me to tell women, married and single, widowed and divorced and separated, that the totality of your financial life should not be on your husband. Your husband is not El Shaddai, else he shall die. Do something with your life. Do not be a liability. My husband and I, many years ago, decided to plan our lives in such a way that in our old age, we will not depend on our children. If Adedotun walks up with his wife and children to give us $1 million, he will feel privileged to give it to us, not because we need it. No. We made up our minds that in the evening of our lives, we will not be dependent on our children and become a liability to them. No matter how great people are, no matter how good and kind people are, they are human beings. Acts chapter 3, the man got up on the strength of Peter. But after some time, he said, Peter, thank you. He began to leap. And then at a point, he began to walk. And he began to praise the Lord. Those of you, because what I'm about to say now, some of you may not want to say amen. Those of you whose life is totally dependent on people, may those people disappoint you. Because God is not raising backboneless believers. If that person does not have it, how will the person give you? the hand of the giver is always at the top. Who says you too cannot be the one that people will depend on? That's why I came. That's my assignment in this convention. To push you to endless honor. And there are some things that must be in your life. There are three major ones. I'm getting there when I'm closing. That must be in your life if you're going to have honor. May your head wear new crowns. When people get tired of helping you, that's what I call compassion fatigue. Burnout. Giver's burnout. I experience it. I say, is it only you? Do you want to kill me? Excuse me. You to go and get a life now. Have I not tried? Compassion fatigue. Don't wait till your life and your relationship gets to that level before you sit up. When being down becomes normal, it affects your self-esteem. If you are always down, they are always giving you. They say a beggar has no choice. You are relocating tonight. A handout is never as valuable as a hand up. Let's go back to Matthew 21. They were now very close to Jerusalem. They got to Bethphage. And Jesus said, let's talk. There has to be a shift. We're going to Jerusalem. Where is Jerusalem? It is a city of peace. It's an unconquerable city. History tells us that Jerusalem has experienced war 22 times. Yet, it is still standing. Every time I go to Israel, I want to go to Jerusalem. In fact, you can't tell me you went to Israel if you don't go to Jerusalem. Thank God for President Trump that relocated the capital of Israel to Jerusalem. That was where they were going. Jesus said, we are going to the place of peace. We're going to the center. We're going to the unconquerable level. That's where we're going. But we're not going to trek there. No, 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 no. We're not trekking there. I pray that God will change your level for good. So let's begin to get into the nitty-gritty of this message. When Jesus made that pronouncement, three major things. If you're going to shift, prophetic declarations. Jesus declared, we are going to Jerusalem. We're coming from somewhere. We are now in Bethphage. But where we are going is Jerusalem, unconquerable city. There is nothing that doesn't grow in Jerusalem. They have rain once or twice a year, but there is no seed that does not grow there. Jesus said, that's where we are going, but we can't trek there. No, we can't. So what did Jesus do? The Bible says he sent two disciples. What did he do? He sent them. There is a time in your life when you no longer ask. Things just come. I am in that season, and I want to hold your right hand by the power of the Holy Spirit and take you there. When almost every time you look at your phone, you find an alert. You don't even know who sends the money. Not one person. Different people. Different, different. I hope somebody is connecting with what I'm saying. It is a level. Jesus sent two disciples. I'm not going into the depth of the two disciples. Everybody needs the two dimension. You need the biological, you need the spiritual. The two. Two. It is not everybody that is struggling. It is not everybody that is struggling. Stop envying people. It's not everybody that is struggling. If somebody is in the front, if somebody has what you don't have, it is because that person knows what you don't know. If you see the way I devour books, before I got married, I read about 107 materials on marriage. 107. Because I didn't like the kind of marriages I saw around me, including my pastor's own. My parents' marriage was not that bad, but that wasn't my dream. So I began to devour. Then, when I got born again, I began to read, and I still read, books, materials on financial blessings. Because I don't want to be at the mercy of my husband. I don't want to be at the mercy of my children. I don't want to be at the mercy of anybody. And then they will say, we are not at home. I had seen my parents suffer. So I didn't want that kind of a life. I began to devour. If you come close to my bed, you will see books on money. Because if somebody has what you don't have, I don't care what you feel about that person. Let me listen. John Avazini said there are 25 reasons why people are not wealthy. So I carried his book and I began to devour. I don't want to be poor. I don't want to go to heaven like Lazarus. I want to go like Abraham. I began to devour. I want my mates to be scarce. I don't want to be a normal woman. I want to be an institution. I began to devour. Life should not end in the kitchen. Life should not end. They should not write your name. She came, she had sex, she had children, and then she died. No, not me. Not me. When my husband brought me and the two kids to this land, May 8, 1987, I stood on the street and I said, I don't know anything about this city. My husband married me. He was a town planner. He has decided now to become a pastor. Lord, you know, he said you called him. I don't understand the whatever. But Lord, I will so much stand by my husband. If he fails, hold me responsible. I said, number two, Lord, when they mention useless women in this area, please let my name be missing. But when they mention 5 or 10 women that you are using, let it please you to put my name. Dare to be different. I want something to happen to you tonight. I contacted God before I came. I am here to shift you. Possibilitize your mentality. Life is better than this. Move. Move up. Stop living a regular, normal life. Let's go to Jerusalem. And we don't trek to Jerusalem. We ride. We're right there. I can't be envious of my driver. Once you are envying somebody, it's a sign that that person is greater than you are. Jesus sent two disciples. Acts chapter 3, Peter and John, two disciples. The crippled man was very close to the temple, but he couldn't go in until the two disciples arrived. Amos chapter 7, verse 5, verse 2. By whom shall Jacob arise? For he is small. There is somebody by whom you shall arise, and that person will locate you. I want you to write this down. And almost every day, pray that God should send them your way. Number one, willing helpers. Number two, unwilling helpers. Whether they like it or not, they just help you. Number three, strategic helpers. Number four, strong helpers. Number five, strange helpers. And number six, successful helpers. Write it on your phone, write it somewhere, put it on your fridge, see it every day till December. Father, send me willing helpers, unwilling helpers, strategic helpers, strong helpers, strange helpers, and successful helpers. We keep talking about the butler and Joseph. If the butler did not have access to Pharaoh, there was no way he could have mentioned Joseph. There are some people that are supposed to be your strategic helpers. God needs to plant them in strategic places. That's why you are not swearing. But tonight, wherever they are, we position them very close to authorities. And they will mention you to Pharaoh. The butler said, I do remember my fault today. Somebody must remember something today about you. Remember, I'm not preaching, I'm prophesying to you. Somebody must remember something about you today. In Germany, in Australia, in Switzerland, in America, in London, in Saudi Arabia, in Japan, in China, somewhere on this planet Earth, as I am speaking God's word, somebody will remember you. There are preachers and there are preachers, so please listen. If you are very close to my husband and to me, you will know that we don't just preach the letter, we have experienced it. In Australia, in America, in Britain, in Europe, somewhere today, may God initiate something on your behalf. You know how I preach. If I'm preaching, I will be going around here. I'm prophesying tonight. I carry something. When I came into church tonight, I felt a heavy weight of glory, and I'm distributing portions now. Wherever it may be, scholarship, it, I don't know, but as I'm speaking now on the altar of God, somebody somewhere will remember you. Something will be initiated in your favor, and that thing, you will never finish it in it. You catching that prophecy? You will not finish it in it. Take your seat. If I have 10 things to share with you in my notes, I am just on number 1A. 1A. I have too much on my inside tonight. The Bible says that Jesus told them, go to the village. You will find the colt and the daughter tied down. As you enter, you will see them. They are the cynosure. And that's the pictorial image of some people's lives. Tied down in the village. I come from a village. It's not a great life. When we have family meeting and we want to go on vacation, my children will never say, let's go to the village. The village is not a great life. And there are destinies wasting in the village. I untie you. Yeah. Marital village, financial village, ministerial village, whatever village. I try to look for the meaning of village. Hear what the dictionary tells me about village. A village is a clustered human settlement. Larger than a hamlet, but smaller than a town. That's my life. Not visible. Hidden glory. Irrelevant. Company of villagers. Hey, Okumo. Hey. Villagers. That's how they greet them in my village. Okumo. Okumo away. Okumo. That's all. And then they eat pounded yam. They don't understand CNN. They don't know that Trump is the president. They don't understand any village life. Limitation. As it was in the beginning, so shall it be. No more. You are shifting. You can tell that I'm really running now. Jesus said, lose them. It's not an advice, it's a command. Bishop told us in the morning, fathers are not advisors. They are instructors. You have a father in your life, stop arguing. When your God-sent mentor is talking to you, shut up and listen and write. One day I was with my mentor. I did not know I would see him. I didn't even have anything on me. I just checked into my bag. I saw my checkbook. I brought it out. I was writing at the back of my checkbook. I'll go and get another one. When your fathers are speaking, you listen. Because fathers are not advisors. He now said, why you are losing the animals? If anybody challenges you, tell them the Lord. And in case you don't know, my husband says some people are not happy that you are happy. They just want you to remain on the same spot. But they are liars. Oh. Because you are coming out. The countdown has begun. In another 6 minutes, I will start the prophesying that I told you about. You are coming out. Get ready. That's why I'm pushing now. So, let me get to this one. In the book of Esther chapter 6, beginning from verse 6. The Bible says, Haman came in, and the king said unto Haman, what shall be done unto the man whom the king delighted to honor? Haman thought in his heart, to whom would the king delight to do honor more than to myself? And Haman answered the king, for the man whom the king delighted to honor, let the royal apparel be brought, which the king used to wear, and the horse that the king rides on, and the crown royal which is set upon his head. And let this apparel and horse be delivered to the hand of one of the king's most noble princes, that they may array the man whither whom the king delighted to honor, and bring him on horseback through the streets of the city. I'm just describing you, and proclaim before him, thus shall it be done to the man whom the king delighted to honor. Then the king said to him, make haste. Take the apparel and the horse, as you have said. Do unto Funke Felix-Adejumo. Let nothing fail of all that you have spoken. Let me repeat this. I've done it before. I want to do it again. If you have a scarf, please give me. I want like 5 or 6 or 10. Be very fast about it. You have a scarf? Please bring it, bring it, bring it, bring it, bring it, bring it, bring it. Thank you. Just spread it. Just spread it anywhere. Spread it anywhere. Thank you. God bless you. Spread it very well, very well. I'm going to work on it. Spread it very well. Thank you. Thank you. That's fine. Thank you. That's fine. So Pastor Gwenga, please come. Thank you. You can go back. Know your scarf. So Jesus climbed on the colt. And the colt began to walk on the dresses of human beings from the village. Show me another mega shift. From the village, the great grandfather never saw it before. Somebody that was tied down, peaches too, tied down. Now, Jesus said, lose him. He now carried Jesus and began to walk. The Bible says, people that didn't have scarf, they went outside. People will bless you even if it is not convenient. I'm not preaching tonight, so you will hear preaching tomorrow. You will hear preaching on Saturday morning. You will hear preaching on Sunday. I am prophesying. I came to this service pregnant. I am in the delivery room. I'm delivering something as a prophetess of God. Somebody that was tied in the village, they now brought the person to the city. And human beings, are they crazy or no? When it is time to honor you, people misbehave. Honor. Dr. Jazz is here. Both of us were with Bishop T.D. Jakes. We were at his meeting. I just sat. And Bishop T.D. Jakes walked up to me and gave me the microphone and told me, bring a word. I said, does he know me? Bring a word. Thank you, Dr. Jazz, for recording, because I didn't even know what I said. And bless God, bless God. But I noticed that the people were shouting and screaming. I said, I must be making sense. So I adjusted myself. And then I said, when it is time to be honored, human beings will bring clothes. God will raise people on whose shoulders you will ride. After I brought that word, Dr. Jazz and I, we were going back to our hotel room, and we say, oh, I like your voice. Oh, that was a word. Who would have known me at Potter's house? Who would have known me? Human beings tied. I live in Akure City. In case you don't know, Akure, United States of Akure. I went to Dallas. Human beings put cloth down. Some of them didn't have cloth. They went to the trees. They said, I need to honor that person. They were cutting palm from. I'm describing what will happen to you. You are shifting into unending honor. You will dip your feet in oil. You will make progress. Because there is a crown on your head now. Touch your head. Royal crown. In the natural, my husband was born a prince. His father reigned in his town, in his hometown. On our wedding night, my husband's family came to my father's house. As poor as we were, their prince was getting married. See, what did they bring? A crown. And his brother led the team. My husband's senior brother led the team and said, this is how we receive a wife for our sons. Any wife that will come to our family must wear a crown as she steps in. So that night they crowned me. You cannot, it can only be experienced. They put a crown on my head. They didn't even put on my husband's head. So when I was joking with him, he said, we are the owner of the crown. I can wear 40 if I want. They put the crown on my head and held my hand. All my mates that we used to hug together years ago, I'm going, waiting life at the rest. That was what the cult was doing that day. Crown. They also put a royal apparel. So when we started having children, my husband said to me, there is something I need to tell you. Now that you have two boys and two girls, on their wedding night or wedding day, their wives will wear crowns like you wore. Eh? It's generational. And your daughters, when they are going, we will put crowns on their heads. Now that we have 7 grandchildren, I'm waiting if Jesus tarries for the day my daughters, my granddaughters will also be going. And I will follow them with the crown. I also want it. Let's go. When you see a king, don't you recognize the king? There is a way kings dress. No matter how full a car is, there will be space for the driver. No matter how poor a city is. My father-in-law died at the age of 100. No day that we went to the palace and Kabiyesi, we say, Kabiyesi means your royal majesty. We say, there is no food here today. No. There may not be food anywhere. Once you become a king, people give you. It is a mystery that I cannot explain. I'm telling you, I may not know how to pray. I may not know how to preach. I may not know how to make some things. Once God decides to honor you for no justifiable reason, people will just be blessing you.